خلاص. السلام عليكم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاه والسلام على رسول الله. وي لايف. الشيخ جزاه الله خير. He started the reciting since yesterday and today now the continuation of سورة النور. Amazing سورة. This سورة we have in fact I have seminars on certain سورة from the Quran. Just سورة النور by itself would take weeks to go through it. سورة النور is a مدني سورة. And then they will talk about, they will also recite Surah Al-Furqan and Surah Al-Shu'ara today, inshallah. Is there any other surah as well? Just up to Shu'ara, I think, right? So three surahs, An-Nur, Al-Furqan, and Al-Shu'ara. An-Nur is a Madani surah, amazing surah. It's a surah, brothers and sisters, that talks about the social affairs and home etiquettes. Surah has lots of laws, but all pertinent to our homes and our dealings with one another. And one of the reasons why the surah was revealed, it happened in Medina, it happened during, you know, one of the incidents that happened at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, as you may have heard of the Hadithatul Ifk, the incident of slandering, the slandering of Aisha, your mother, my mother, the mother of the believers, Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha, when she was slandered by the hypocrites. You know, first was this hypocrite who spread, you know, divulged this news that she committed, astaghfirullah, zina. Wrongly, he accused her of committing zina with a man by the name of Safwan bin Mu'attal. It's a long story, but the summary of it, she was accused of committing zina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to reveal ayat, you know, to show the innocence of Aisha radiallahu anha wa arda'ha. Surah An-Nur. She says, Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, by Allah, Safwan, he did not talk to me. He didn't even look at me. They were traveling. And then Aisha radiallahu anha, she lost a necklace. So she went looking for her necklace. When they came back, the Sahaba were there. They were just resting. Then the Prophet Muhammad, sometimes when he used to go on his expeditions, sometimes he used to take his wives with him. So that was the time of Aisha, her turn. So he took her with him. And then Aisha, as she was light, they used to have this thing called al-awdaj. It's like a little tent that they used to put on these camels. So the mother of the believer will go inside this awdaj. So when they go on a rest, they would take this awdaj and put it down. Aisha radiallahu anha, she came out to take care of her needs, and then she lost her necklace. She came back. And then she said, my necklace, my necklace. Then she went looking for her necklace. They came back. They thought that Aisha, she's in her awdaj because she was light. They carried the awdaj, they put it on the camel, and they proceeded. Aisha, she came back. She did not find no one. She sat down and waited. Because why? Prophet Muhammad always used to leave someone behind, you know, and then, you know, to follow the army in case if somebody drops anything or whatnot, that person would come in, pick it up and go. That man was Safwan bin Mu'attal. He saw Aisha, he recognized her from far. He says, Umm al-Mu'mineen, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. That's what he said. He came, brought her the camel, and then he turned back. Aisha says, wallahi, he didn't even look at me nor talk to me. And then they walked together until Medina. He did not speak a word. Who was at the entrance of Medina? The head of the hypocrites. What's his name? What's his name? Who said that? If you want chocolate, who said? Huh? What, he said, you said, she said, who said, man? I said. Abdullah ibn Ubay. Because his son was a believer. So anyways, he accused her of committing zina. For 1 month, al-wahy was not revealed. For 1 month. So, and there was a big chaos that happened in Medina, so much so that even some Sahabis, they started divulging the news that Aisha radiallahu anha committed zina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down this ayah to show the innocence of Aisha radiallahu anha wa ta'ala. Also, the surah talks about lots of adab. First of the adab, or first of the etiquettes, permission when entering home. This surah, sisters, this surah is mostly for you. Adab of entering our homes. Permission. Before you go to someone's home, you need to ask permission to enter. And let me talk about something quickly here, because something that we can all relate to. Sometimes we have families that live together. You have the father, the mother, the daughters and the brothers, and maybe the brother or the son gets married, his wife she's living with him, and the brother has to have another brother, what we call the brother outlaw, I mean the brother in-law. You don't get it, huh?
the in-laws living together,
everybody's living together. The Prophet Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he says, when they got to the brother-in-law, the son, Alhamu al-Mawt. Alhamu al-Mawt. Mawt in Arabic means death. It's not like, because I'm just his brother, and then you have your sister's wife, your brother's wife, right? Yeah, the brother's wife, she's home by herself, and then, you know, you leave, and then you just go in, and, oh, it's my home, my parents' home, and I live here. La ya habibi. Islam has etiquettes. Islam tells us not to mingle with one another. So you need adab. You know, asking permission before you enter. This surah talks about ghadd al-basar, lowering the gaze. This surah talks about hijab. The surah talks about the prohibition of zina. This surah talks about the prohibition of slandering, of al-fahisha. This surah is filled with adab and filled with ahkam. Go back and read it, inshallah ta'ala. Also, the next surah is surah al-Furqan. Furqan is like Faraq, yeah. Umar Faruq. Why is it called Faruq? Faraq. Differentiate between al-haq wal-batil. Surah al-Furqan, it differentiates between falsehood and between al-haq, between the truth. The surah talks about, it has a beautiful, you know, from beautiful ayah that talk about ibad al-Rahman. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا وَإِذَا خَطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. Beautiful description of the ibad of al-Rahman, the slaves of Allah al-Rahman. الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا. Those walk peacefully on earth. وَإِذَا خَطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. When the jahil speak to them, they say salam. They don't get involved in idle talk. They're peaceful. And those who make dua for their families, it's such a very beautiful, you know, qualities. Please read them, inshallah ta'ala. And then 6:45, 7 minutes. I still have 2 more minutes, inshallah ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Surah Ash-Shu'ara. So Shu'ara is an interesting surah. Shu'ara in Arabic means poets. The surah talks about the methods or the means used at the time by the prophets in propagating their message. At the time of the Prophet Muhammad, one of the means was using poetry. As if today, if we were to have this analogy, today would be media. At the time was poets. Shi'r, poetry. What do we use today, or what is the most efficient things that people can use today to propagate the message of Islam? Is media, social media. So that's why Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, when He says, Al-Shu'ara yattabi'uhum al-ghawun. Yes, you know, the Shu'ara, a lot of them are misguided, except that Allah Azza wa Jalla, illa alladhina amanu, except those who believes, because social media or media is a double-edged sword. You could use it for something good, or you could use it for something bad. So a lot of our youth here today, all of them, I would say, everybody's using social media, don't you? Yeah, you know, Instagram, Insta, do you use Facebook? I mean, Facebook? Sometimes, TikTok now, right? Is the no?
I don't use it. Huh?
I don't use it. But what's the trend today? What's the trend today? Twitter? Twitter, that's you, man, because you're old. the youngsters, what do they use today? I'm just joking. TikTok, exactly. Can you use that to spread Islam? Can you use that means to do something good for La ilaha illallah? It's between your hands. Use it in a good way, inshallah ta'ala. An ayah that will change your life. In Surah Al-Furqan, verse number 68, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, 68, 69, 70.
والذين لا يدعون مع الله إلها آخر ولا يقتلون النفس التي حرم الله إلا بالحق ولا يزنون ومن يفعل ذلك يلقى أثاما يضاعف له العذاب يوم القيامة ويخلد فيه مهانا إلا من تاب وآمن وعمل عملا صالحا فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات وكان الله غفورا رحيما.
One of the most hopeful ayah in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ. And those who do not call or associate anyone with Allah Azza wa Jal. And those who do not kill innocent lives. And those who do not commit zina. And whosoever does so, he shall have a very severe punishment. And he will be thrown in hellfire. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. And but Allah Azza wa Jal comes in with the golden part right here. Except, إِلَّا. Three against three. Those who associate someone with worship of Allah, those who commit zina, or those who kill innocent lives, and those who commit zina. Three major sins. And then in regard Allah Azza wa Jalla says, except those illa man taba wa amana wa amila amalan saliha. Except those who repent, illa man tab, tab, repent, amana, who believe, wa amila amalan saliha, and work righteousness. What will happen to them? You may say, Shaykh, and it had happened to me many times. People come and say, I don't think Allah will forgive me. I don't think. Because I've committed such a very horrible crime, I don't think Allah will forgive me. I say, how many people have you killed? No, nobody. But why you say, Allah forgive the man who killed 100 lives? Wouldn't he forgive you? Allah forgive the man who killed the uncle of Prophet Muhammad. What's his name? The uncle of Prophet Muhammad? Hamza. Who killed him? Wahshi. Allah forgave Wahshi. Wouldn't he forgive you? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, except those who make who repent, those who believe, and those who work righteousness. What will happen to them? أُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Those Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only will forgive them, listen, I'm done. Not only Allah will forgive them, Allah will forgive them and convert all their bad deeds into good deeds. All the bad deeds will be converted into good deeds. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Allah is the most forgivable. Allah is the oft forgivable, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Him to forgive us all, inshallah, in this blessed month. To forgive our sins, to forgive our shortcomings. He forgives. We are the sinners. He is the forgiver, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're weak. We commit sins day in and day out. And He is al-ghafur al-ghafar. He forgives day in and day out. I ask Him to, inshallah, ta'ala, shower His mercy upon us. Jazakumullah khair, barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.